And so our next question here is actually inspired by one of our listeners to our show. So we asked our followers on Instagram what questions they may have for you, given your background. And Megan was wondering, do performance and sustainability ever have trade-offs when it comes to innovations in this industry? And if so, how do you find the optimal balance between the two?
Yeah, I would say everything has a trade-off. Yeah. No matter what you're comparing. We talked about that a little bit already. You know, if you want something to be waterproof and breathable, there's a trade-off there. And so usually the materials that make it to marketplace are some optimal balance of the two, you know, given the cost restrictions as well that we talked about a little bit. For sustainability, depends on how you define it. There are lots of different ways to define it. We do lots of consumer insight studies at Columbia. And one of the things that we've learned is that consumers in general have very different ideas of what sustainability actually means. And, you know, as scientists and engineers, it's easy for us to understand because, you know, a given material may be good in terms of reducing energy consumption, but it may not be as good in terms of water consumption, right? So so that's what I mean by different ways to define sustainability. You're trying to minimize water consumption, trying to minimize energy consumption. Are you trying to create something that's going to be easy to recycle? Are you trying to create something that is going to be easy to reuse? So there are lots of different ways to consider sustainability. But it's become such an important part, and always has been an important part, especially of the outdoor industry, right? Because the last thing that we want to do as an industry is damage the environment that we're trying to encourage people to go out and spend more time in, right? So, you know, ethically, morally, as well as from a business perspective, it's just not a smart thing for us to do. So it's part of everything that we do and everything we consider. And I can tell you that in terms of materials, there are a lot of incredible materials that have a lower footprint, no matter how you measure that, whether it's reduced water consumption, whether it's reduced energy consumption. They have lower footprints that we could use. Sometimes cost gets in the way, though. And what I mean by that is if we go to more expensive materials, that means less people are going to be able to use them. And so that's always part of the equation. So in terms of a trade-off, I would say the big trade-off and one of the things that we focus our innovation efforts on is trying to create more sustainable materials at cost neutral, even less expensive than the current materials we're using. And that's a challenge.
No, for sure. So do you guys also like pay attention to the fashion landscape too? Like this question is inspired by another one of our followers, Manuel, and he was just wondering, do fashion trends change the direction of R&D? And if so, how?
I love that question. And I love that question because we just released a product called OmniHeat Black Dot, which is really the result of years of research on radiative heat transfer. And, you know, I described earlier our product OmniHeat Reflective, which are these little silver dots on the liner of a jacket that reflect your own body heat. OmniHeat Black Dot, as the name implies, little black dots on the exterior of the jacket, on the shell fabric. And it's a multi-layered, multifunctional, we call it a heat management element. It has first a very thin layer of aluminum. Well, that's the metal part. And on top of that, it has a very thin layer of a black coating. Now, what we discovered in our research was we knew that the metal had low emissivity.
Before we move on in this conversation, I'd like to define one term, which is thermal emissivity. Thermal emissivity describes the effectiveness in which a surface of a material emits energy as thermal radiation. So let's unpack that a little bit. Thermal radiation is that same sort of energy you feel walking outside on a sunny day, which is from the sun invariably, which is transmitted to the Earth via light of various frequencies. So, if you're able to tailor the properties of materials to have unique thermal emissivity properties, you can get some interesting results, as we are about to describe in this part of the conversation.
And so we put the metal on the outside of the jacket in the form of dots, because we want it to remain breathable again. But we put it on the outside of the jacket to limit thermal emissivity into the environment. If you look at all the, and I'm going to digress here for a second, but you guys are material scientists and engineers, and we already talked about heat transfer, so you're going to like this. if you look at the fundamental equations of heat transfer for convection, conduction, and radiation, you know, there are different terms in those equations. If you look at the heat flux due to convection, heat flux due to conduction, heat flux due to radiation, different terms in those equations, But there's a common term in every one of those, and that's delta T, the difference in temperature, meaning that heat transfers from where it is to where it ain't, depending on the temperature difference between the thing that has the heat to the place that doesn't have the heat. So a human in a cold environment wearing a jacket, you know, that jacket's going to warm up because it's next to your skin. And then the biggest gradient in temperature, the biggest delta T, is going to be from the shell fabric to the environment, right? Because you think about it, the liner fabric and then the insulation layer is closer to your body than the shell fabric. The shell fabric is the farthest from your body. And if you're in a cold environment, the biggest difference in temperature between all the layers of the jacket and the cold environment is going to be from the shell. Simply because the jacket's, it's like a, you know, it's a big, you're basically wearing a blanket. It's going to warm up because it's next to your body. And so we recognize that things we can do to the shell fabric to limit heat transfer to the environment are going to play a big role. And so that's why we recognize that, okay, for years we've been putting this stuff on the liner fabric, which works, but we should really start to focus our efforts on the shell fabric. So we put these black dots on the shell fabric, the first iteration of the technology, which is aluminum dots, but you look like a disco ball walking around, all silver dots. We weren't so sure that, you know, that consumers would be crazy about that look. We had a designer on the innovation team at the time, and she said to me, she said, Haskell, why don't you just make them black? And I thought, well, that's a great idea. The problem with that technically, though, when she first mentioned that, if you take a metal like aluminum and you put a black polymeric coating on it, the emissivity goes back up. So the secret sauce and the part that we figured out was how to put a black coating on a metal without letting the emissivity, the thermal emissivity, go back up. So we've created basically a low emissivity fabric that limits your heat transfer from the jacket into the cold environment. The bonus, which we didn't fully appreciate at the time, was because it's black, of course, it's going to absorb solar radiation. Everybody knows that, right? Black absorbs sunlight more than white. But what we didn't recognize, and this was a surprising part of the invention, was that because you got this thin black coating on this aluminum layer, that it works very effective as a solar capture mechanism. And so the black layer absorbs solar, converts it to heat. That aluminum layer then conducts it down into the insulation layer. And now, because you're underneath a low emissivity shell fabric, it gets trapped. So we're calling this a heat magnet. And so I realize this is a long answer to your question, but the reason I went through that is because, you know, it has a distinct look. The black dots are a little bit glossy. If you look at the product online now or in retail stores, you'll see it looks kind of fashionable.
Yeah.
And as it turns out, you know, the question was about fashion and trends. It turns out black and shiny is kind of trending right now, which is just lucky for us because this particular product, which is nothing but technically based, really has a fashion element to it that we hope will help it sell. So I appreciate the question for a number of reasons. I went through one of them. The other thing is that when we do our work on the innovation team, we interface with our design team, and then they take it and make it beautiful and put it into a beautiful product people will, I think, enjoy wearing and be proud to wear.
That's awesome that you didn't even really think about that at first, you know, with the different coloring, but the fact that, you know, black is in, right, required that additional innovation, which really translated to even more technological advancement in that area. That's really cool.
Yeah. And actually, just a plug for that technology, I said, we just released it this fall. It's been on the market for a month or two now, but it was just named as one of the top 100 innovations of 2020 by Popular Science.
Wow. Congratulations.
Yeah. Thank you. We're pretty proud of that. Very cool. It's the first time a low emissivity fabric has ever been integrated, to our knowledge, in a garment.